Today's sponsor is the Freedom Forum's Religious Freedom Center. Check out their ongoing series on American religious history brought to you in part by the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations. What are the least religious countries in the world? Well, pop on over to Wikipedia and you'll find this handy list based on a Gallup poll that ranks countries by lowest rates of religiosity. China, Sweden, and the Czech Republic top the list of people claiming that they are not religious. Case closed. But not so fast. This whole video will indeed be about China, Scandinavia, and the Czech Republic, but you can't possibly describe the religiosity of these countries by one statistic. I say this a lot on this channel, but I'll repeat it. Religious identity involves beliefs, rituals, and communal identities. Religion is also embedded in all aspects of culture, from art to politics, and these are not always equally weighted. Some religious communities emphasize correct belief over rituals. Others emphasize cultural affiliation more than behavior or belief. And we should take this into account when asking, what are the least religious countries? Does least religious mean fewer people believing in God or a supernatural reality? Does it mean fewer people participating in religious rituals or fewer people affiliating with a particular religious identity? For this video, I'll be trying to account for all three of these metrics: affiliation, beliefs, and activity. We also need to be aware of our own bias for what religion even is in the first place. So, as an American, I live in a country that has a long Protestant history. And because of that, lots of people in this country, Protestant or not, kind of think about religion like Protestants. That religion is primarily about your internal thoughts and beliefs. The sort of theology that says if you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Tied to this, I've noticed that a lot of studies try to measure religiosity from a Christian-centric or even a Protestant-centric perspective. For example, measuring religious practice by focusing on how often people attend a weekly religious service. So, if we define religiosity as weekly service attendance and what you believe about God, we might accidentally skew our analysis of countries where religious expression is totally different. So, for example, looking at this handy Wikipedia page of the least religious countries, Japan is really high on this list. Some studies show that 72% don't follow any religion, and there are high rates of atheism. But well over half of Japan's population regularly attends Shinto shrines, and most of these people don't identify as Shinto. So I'd say Japan is still religious in a sense, but not in the sense of exclusive membership to a particular religious identity or belief in a specific orthodoxy. So now that I've spent several minutes for my "this is more complicated than you think" disclaimer, let's dive in. First in our tour around the world is Europe. Now, lots of countries in Europe are secularized, but I want to focus specifically on Scandinavia. Scandinavia has a long religious history. It was the land of the Norse gods in ancient times before it was Christianized during the medieval period. Medieval stav churches still dot the landscape of Norway, and following the Protestant Reformation, Scandinavia became a hub for Lutheranism as the local monarchs accepted it as their religion. But now, here in the 21st century, Norway, Denmark, and Sweden are among the least religious countries in the world by all three metrics of affiliation, beliefs, and activity. According to a 2016 survey, atheists outnumber theists in Norway, 39% of the population versus 37% of the population. As for Denmark and Sweden, a 2017 survey found that only 36% of Danes and Swedes believe in God. But that's belief. The numbers are even more stark for religious practice. Only 4% of Danes and 5% of Norwegians regularly attend church. I've seen studies that show as few as 1.3% of Swedes that attend church regularly. As for daily prayer, the numbers are in the low double digits. Compared to the United States, these are dramatically low rates of religious observance. Religious affiliation is a little trickier, though. Huge percentages of the population are officially members of their respective national churches: the Church of Sweden, the Church of Norway, and the Church of Denmark. All three of them Lutheran, and two of them, the Church of Denmark and the Church of Sweden, are actually supported by the state via church taxes from their members. So, in Denmark and Sweden, even if a bunch of them never pray and never attend church, they still retain their church membership or baptize their kids. In fact, almost half of Swedish babies are baptized in the Church of Sweden. This is a good example of why measuring religiosity requires measuring multiple factors. Because of the extremely low rates of religious belief and practice, some scholars characterize these church members as belonging without believing, and that church membership serves a largely secular purpose as a connection to a Swedish cultural heritage. So, I'm comfortable describing Scandinavia as one of the most secular places on Earth, but that doesn't necessarily mean thoroughly secular or overwhelmingly atheist. Remember, a solid third of the population are still theists. A big chunk of the population still clearly believe in some sort of supernatural reality. Christianity is still clearly embedded in culture. But, as some scholars have argued, Scandinavian populations are characterized by religious indifference, not the hostile rejection of religion. Now, why it became so secular is an impossibly complicated question to answer. Some scholars have put forth an existential insecurity theory of secularization, which says that removing the fear of personal catastrophe and improving the conditions of life leads to a more secular society. Secular institutions such as strong welfare systems, healthcare systems, and insurance programs helps reduce existential insecurity and dread. They insulate you from the hardships of life. On the flip side, some studies have also suggested that religiosity rises during hardships such as war. I have a whole video on the theory that war-torn countries experience higher rates of religiosity following the war, possibly because religion works as a form of terror management. So, as the theory goes, Scandinavian countries are highly modernized, wealthy countries with robust social programs, which help secularize these countries by removing existential insecurity. Of course, this is one plausible explanation for what is certainly a multi-factor complex system. Plenty of modernized countries around the globe still see high rates of religiosity, so don't go thinking this is the one and only explanation for what we're seeing on the ground in Scandinavia. But what about the rest of Europe? Estonia and the Czech Republic are two countries that often top the list of least religious countries in the world. I want to focus on the latter. Like Scandinavia, the Czech Republic has low rates of belief in God, low rates of religious observance, and super high rates of unaffiliation. 72% are unaffiliated, and included in that 72% is a whopping 25% of the population that identifies as atheist. The Czech Republic is an interesting case study because it demonstrates what happens when nearly an entire generation is raised without religious affiliation. 64% of Czech adults were raised without a religion. As for the current generation of Czech parents, 79% are raising their kids without religion. And we may be seeing an effect from this on the younger generation. In 2018, 91% of Czechs between 16 and 29 years old claimed no religious affiliation at all. 91%. This is a big deal because your parents' religion is a strong predictor of your own religious identity. Part of the reason why is what sociologists call credibility-enhancing displays, or creds. This is the idea that religious actions speak louder than religious words. Children witnessing their parents and authority figures living out their beliefs and participating in rituals, especially costly rituals that require commitment, demonstrate to the child that these beliefs are true, which results in higher rates of children adopting that belief for themselves into adulthood, and making it more likely that they will pass those beliefs on to the next generation. Of course, we need to consider history here as well. For those of you who are a little older in the audience, you might remember when the Czech Republic was part of Czechoslovakia. It was a satellite state of the Soviet Union for the latter half of the 20th century until the so-called Velvet Revolution in 1989, which ended the one-party communist government. During these decades of authoritarian rule, the communist regime actively suppressed religion. But while Slovakia returned to high levels of religiosity after the fall of the Soviet Union, the Czech Republic continued to secularize. In 1950, 94% of Czechs identified with a religious group, most of those Catholic. But by 1991, that had dropped to 44%. The scholars Aiyana Willard and Lubomir Cingle suggest that this communist ban on religiosity probably sparked this decline, which then had knock-on effects for later generations. In their huge study comparing religiosity in Slovakia versus the Czech Republic, they found childhood church attendance was a strong predictor of current religious participation and current belief in God. It was a way stronger predictor for current religious identity than education or even existential insecurity like poverty. Basically, if you had experienced credibility-enhancing displays as a kid at church, you had a higher chance of remaining religious as an adult. But with so many unaffiliated parents, the next generation of Czechs were raised receiving basically no creds, which essentially ended the cultural transmission of religious identity. But even among the Czechs, we see high rates of spiritual or supernatural beliefs. 45% believe in fortune tellers, 40% in faith healers, 30% in the power of horoscopes. This leads some scholars to conclude that the Czech population can better be described as unchurched rather than irreligious. So keep in mind that unaffiliated doesn't necessarily mean thoroughly atheist. Now, there are other countries in Europe that we could study. Estonia, Hungary, the United Kingdom, the Netherlands, Belgium, France, all of these have very high rates of religious unaffiliation. But I want to move on to Asia. Remember from our handy Wikipedia list, China was at the top. And by a lot of metrics, this is true. But the numbers are tricky. According to the Pew Templeton Foundation, 18.2% of the Chinese are Buddhist, 5% are Christian, 22% are categorized as folk religions, though the scholar of Chinese religion, Adam Yuet Chow, surmises this includes Taoists, 2% are Muslim, and 52% are unaffiliated. So over half of Chinese are religiously unaffiliated, at least according to this study. But the rates of non-religion in general and atheism specifically might be much higher. I found studies that show 70% of Chinese adults are non-believers. Another said somewhere between 82 to 86% are unaffiliated. So yes, the numbers differ somewhat from study to study, but they show a very secular nation. As for religious practice, other surveys have found only 3% of the population say that religion is important to their daily lives, and only 1% pray daily. So extremely low rates of practice, but I got a sense while researching this section that it's really difficult to conduct surveys on religious identity in China, particularly because many Chinese people don't share the kind of understanding of religious identity that's so common in Western countries. What Adam Yuet Chow calls confessional affiliational understanding of mutually exclusive religious membership. Okay, that's fancy academic speak, but basically what he's describing is the understanding of religious membership that stipulates if you identify yourself as a Christian, you can't also be a Muslim as well. It's mutually exclusive. But in China, you can find atheists who practice Tao rituals. There are people who practice Buddhist rituals but don't call themselves Buddhist on a survey. The reason for these low rates of religious affiliation are both historical and political. As with the Czech Republic, authoritarian regimes instituted secularizing and anti-religion campaigns all throughout the 20th century. Later, after the Chinese Communist Party came to power, the government instituted a campaign to smash the four olds: old customs, old cultures, old habits, and old ideas. In other words, they attempted to eradicate pre-communist Chinese cultural elements, which included criminalizing religious practices and texts, imprisoning or executing religious leaders, destroying countless temples, churches, and mosques. The Red Guards even destroyed the tomb of Confucius, one of the most famous Chinese philosophers of all time. Today, although religion is experiencing somewhat of a revival in China, the country remains overwhelmingly secular. You see, the Chinese Communist Party is officially atheist. Members must be atheist and will be expelled from the party if they claim a religious membership or identity. And the Chinese government continues to crack down on religious communities it views as dangerous to public order. Here in 2020, we're witnessing a mass campaign to imprison Uyghur Muslims in internment camps. In the late 90s, the Chinese government launched atheism promotion campaigns in the Tibetan Autonomous Zone to coerce Tibetan Buddhists to abandon their religion. And they've enacted persecution campaigns against new religious movements such as the Falun Gong. So the weight of this history of repression leads the sociologists David Palmer and Fabian Winiger to write, "One would be hard-pressed to find any other country in the world in which the place of religion in society has been so rigidly circumscribed, its exclusion from other spheres so complete, its public presence so minimal." But as other sociologists have argued, secularization in China was not so much a historical process, but a secularizing project that sought to remove religion from society. Now, I could keep listing countries, but my goal with this video is not to replicate a Wikipedia list. My goal is to complicate what we mean when we label a country as not very religious. Secularism is a very different phenomenon when we compare a place like Sweden with a place like China. None of these examples followed the exact same historical trajectory, but scholars in the early and mid-20th century assumed that all countries would kind of follow the same historical trajectory, marching toward greater and greater secularity as they modernized. This theory is generally called the secularization thesis, which stipulated that traditional religions are in terminal decline in the industrialized world. that religion will increasingly disappear from public and even private life because of new scientific discoveries and modernization. Sociologists in the 20th century were convinced that this would happen sooner rather than later, but I'm not seeing it happen anytime soon. If 91% of Gen Z in the Czech Republic are truly non-religious, maybe we will see it there in a generation or two. But as we saw earlier, even this one statistic can be misleading, since large percentages within this 91% could be practicing some form of unchurched spirituality. As for China, some scholars argue we're actually seeing a resurgence of religion in China as the government has loosened its laws and modernized over the past few decades, which is kind of the opposite of the classic secularization thesis, which says increased modernization means less religion. From my perspective, while it's clear to me that certain countries around the world can definitely be called irreligious or non-religious, the classical secularization thesis that religion is in terminal decline has not yet been proven by the data. Hey everyone, today's sponsor is the Freedom Forum's Religious Freedom Center. They're a nonprofit, non-sectarian organization committed to educating the public about the First Amendment principles of the US Constitution. They're friends of the show, and we've collaborated over the years on a bunch of different religious literacy projects. You may have heard in one of my previous videos that they're hosting a series of virtual seminars over Zoom on critical social movements in American religious history. The next one will be on Thursday, October 8 at 1 o'clock p.m. That's US East Coast time. The speakers will explore the continuing struggle for voting rights after the 15th and 19th Amendments, which, here in 2020, became law exactly 150 years ago and 100 years ago, respectively. You'll learn about the original 33 Georgia legislators who were elected to office during the post-Civil War Reconstruction era, but were immediately expelled because of their color. And you'll learn about the activism of Dr. Charlotte Hawkins Brown, a pioneer in education and race relations who faced racist opposition as women's first opportunity to vote neared in 1920. This series is made possible by support from the Arthur Vining Davis Foundations, who support religious literacy programming. Click on the link in the description below to register. It's completely free. And as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.